Hey everyone, my name is Sahil. I'm an MCAT tutor here at Shemmassian Academic Consulting. We've got a bio and biochem passage here today, so I'll be going over this and how you can approach questions like these on the MCAT. So we've got the passage pulled up here in front of me. I'm gonna just walk you guys through this, think out loud a bit so you know exactly what's going on in my head. For test day, you'll be wanting to go at a pace of about 8 minutes per passage for this section of the exam. But you know, since I'm walking through this, I won't be going quite at that pace. So without further ado, let's go ahead and just dive right into this. All right, so a common feature of cancer cells is their ability to rewire their metabolism to sustain the production of ATP and macromolecules needed for cell growth, division, and survival. In particular, altered fatty acid metabolism has been found to play an extensive role in cancer pathogenesis. This has resulted in substantial clinical interest in developing therapies that target the reprogramming of fatty acid metabolism. Pharmacological inhibitors of key lipid metabolism enzymes have seen varying degrees of success. All right, so I often like to apply the outlining method in most sections, but especially for the bio and biochem one, especially because they're gonna have like a lot of preliminary information and it gets really detailed. So I wanna be able to kind of pick out what's kind of the main stuff that I need to be focused on. And so after reading this paragraph, I'm really getting the sense that it's gonna be a lot about metabolism and in particular, fatty acid metabolism. So to summarize this, I'm gonna talk about the lipid metabolism, but I also wanna touch on how they're talking about this in the context of cancer metabolism. So maybe I would put for this paragraph, lipid metabolism in cancer, and then they were also looking at inhibitors as well. So I'll just put a little note to myself that this is where I can find stuff about the inhibitors. All right, after writing that, I like it. Let's go ahead and move on to the second paragraph. First generation fatty acid synthase, or FASN, targeting drugs such as C75, orlistat, and Seralenin, I'm pretty sure I just butchered that, but bear with me here, initially showed great promise in preclinical studies. In addition to decreasing the synthesis of saturated lipids, they were also found to inhibit tumor growth. However, due to their weak specificity, FASN targeting drugs indirectly activated carnitine acyltransferase 1, or CAT1, in peripheral tissue. Next generation FASN targeting drugs have been found to display higher specificity with limited off-target effects. All right, so seems like we're talking about these type of inhibitors, or specifically these FASN inhibitors. So I wanna make a note about that the first generation ones were able to inhibit tumor growth, but then they were also activating this carnitine acyltransferase 1 as well. So maybe to summarize here, I would write first gen FASN inhibitors, they were blocking tumor growth, but they were also indirectly activating CAT1. Alrighty, let's go ahead and now move on to our third paragraph. Citrate lyase is an enzyme in the cell cytoplasm that catalyzes the breakdown of citrate into acetyl-CoA and oxaloacetate. Inhibitors targeting citrate lyase have also been of interest to researchers due to the increased expression and activity of the enzyme found in several tumor types. Certain ACLY or citrate lyase inhibitors, such as ETC1002, have been found to be well tolerated and highly effective in lowering LDL cholesterol in patients with cardiovascular disease, thus indicating that ACLY inhibition could represent a well tolerated therapeutic strategy. All right, so key thing here is they brought up another inhibitor, this ETC1002, and just this little, I can come up with like this little flow chart in a way of what the mechanism is. So what I'm getting is that we have ETC1002 inhibiting this ACLY or citrate lyase. And then this all is gonna just lead to a decrease in LDL cholesterol, which is what they mentioned right here. So I like drawing out these little pathways or these little flow charts or diagrams when there's many different enzymes being discussed, and then like drugs are being brought up and how exactly they're impacting not just the enzymes, but also maybe like other things that are going on in the body. So such as like these downstream effects where LDL gets lowered, or maybe we have some tumor growth that can occur. So just drawing this all out in like a diagram format just makes it easier to visualize than having to kind of reread it over and over again, like in these paragraphs here. All right, so I like this outline or this summary for paragraph 3. So let's go ahead and dive into our final paragraph. Researchers are also interested in developing dietary interventions to address altered lipid metabolism in cancer cells. It has been demonstrated that a low carbohydrate, high fat diet dramatically increases the efficiency of P13K inhibitors, and synergistically it reduces the growth of P1K3CA mutant tumors. Figure 1 illustrates P13K alpha mTOR signaling. Alrighty. And then, yep, here's figure 1, and we can see that we got this P13K alpha, and then also looks like downstream we're getting this tumor growth here where it says tumorigenesis. So to summarize, seems like when we have low carb, high fat, we're gonna get some activation of, or it's gonna increase the efficiency, right? Where they mention here that it increased the efficiency of these P13K inhibitors. And then that leads to a decrease in tumors, which makes sense. So with if these P13K is being inhibited, then there'd be less of this tumorigenesis occurring, so you would have a decrease in tumors. So now after we read through the passage, we've glanced at the figure as well, we can go ahead and now just dive into our questions. So for question one, the indirect activation of CAT1 by, oh, there's that that drug that I butchered earlier, serulenin, may have resulted in which of the following side effects? A, weight loss, B, frequent urination, C, arterial plaque calcification, or D, hypoglycemia. All right, well, good thing the MCAT doesn't take off points for pronunciation here. Otherwise, I would have not gotten this one correct. But let's talk about like the reasoning behind this. So you need to know for this question that CAT1, or as they mentioned in the passage here, carnitine acyltransferase, it's an enzyme that catalyzes the rate limiting step of beta oxidation, which is the breakdown of fatty acids. So if we were to indirectly activate it, we would have a more breakdown of our fat stores. And then if our fat stores are being broken down, then that would mean we would actually have some weight loss occurring. So out of all of these answer choices, that's going to make A our best answer. All right, let's go ahead and move on to our second question. Says, which of the following is a potential effect of ETC-1002? All right, we have A, accumulation of citrate in cytoplasm, B, accumulation of citrate in the mitochondrion, C, accumulation of acetyl-CoA in the cytoplasm, or D, both B and C. All right, so the passage mentioned to us that ETC-1002 is an inhibitor of citrate lyase. The passage also told us that citrate lyase catalyzes the breakdown of citrate into acetyl-CoA and oxaloacetate in the cell cytoplasm. So just from that information, the fact that it's in the cytoplasm, we actually can pretty much eliminate B right here, because that mentions the mitochondrion. And if B is incorrect, then D is going to be incorrect as well, since D says B is a correct answer. But then, if we reason through this a little bit more, if we have this citrate lyase being inhibited, right, then what's going to happen is that our reactants, like on the left side of this equation, that this enzyme catalyzes, is going to accumulate, and we're not going to have much of the product's formation. So with citrate lyase being inhibited, that means our citrate won't be broken down, and instead it's going to just start accumulating, and that's going to make, out of all these answer choices, A the best answer. Because for C, you know, it talks about acetyl-CoA. Well, citrate lyase breaks down the citrate to produce acetyl-CoA as well as oxaloacetate. So if citrate lyase is being inhibited, that acetyl-CoA and the oxaloacetate will not be formed. So A is our best answer because, yep, it talked about citrate and it mentioned that it's in the cytoplasm. All right, let's go ahead and move on to question three. Which of the following amino acids could not, this is key. It's very easy during the MCAT because it's an exhausting exam to overlook some very little words like this. So oftentimes when I was doing my practice test or section banks or question banks and even on my actual exam, I like to highlight when it would say things like not or least likely or except, just so I could keep myself alert that remember we're looking for what's not gonna be what they're asking for here kind of. So make sure here we're looking for what could not be a potential phosphorylation site for the insulin receptor shown in figure one. All right, so basically this question is gonna be testing our amino acids knowledge, right? We got threonine for A, tyrosine for B, tryptophan for C, and serine for D. For the MCAT, you should know that there are three amino acids that can be phosphorylated. Those are gonna be ones that have a free hydroxyl group, and that's gonna be our serine, it's gonna be threonine, and it's gonna be tyrosine. So our best answer here is gonna be C, tryptophan, because it lacks that free hydroxyl group. So it is not one of those amino acids that you'll see as one that gets phosphorylated. And if you're not familiar with your amino acid structures, I'll go ahead and go to this slide here. So you can take a look at some screenshots from our content guide on proteins, and that includes structures on all the amino acids that you'll need to know, but I've copy and pasted some the relevant structures for this question. So we can see for tryptophan here, there's no hydroxyl group, but for serine, there it is. For threonine, there it is. And for tyrosine, there it is. So of course, since tryptophan lacks that hydroxyl group, as we said earlier, it's gonna be our best answer for this question. Alrighty, let's go ahead and now go on to question four. Based on the information provided in the passage, why might a low carbohydrate diet reduce tumorigenesis? All right, so we have low carb diets or low carbohydrate diets would increase blood insulin levels, thus inhibiting AKT activation, or B, low carbohydrate diets would increase blood insulin levels, thus inhibiting P1K3 alpha activation. C, low carbohydrate diets would limit blood insulin, resulting in increased AKT activation, or D, low carbohydrate diets would limit blood insulin, resulting in decreased activation of P1K3 alpha. All right, so let's reason through this. Since we know that carbohydrates will spike insulin levels, a diet that's gonna be low in carbohydrates will basically do the opposite. It would limit blood insulin levels. So from that alone, we can go ahead and eliminate answer choices, believe A and B, because they both mention this increase, right? So that can't be correct. Because low carbohydrate, we would expect to do the opposite here. Now, we should then look at figure one. We can see here in figure one that downstream of the activation of this insulin receptor is the activation of P1K3 alpha, AKT, and then also, of course, we get, ultimately at the end of the day, tumorigenesis. So now if insulin levels decrease, then all three of these, P1K3 alpha, AKT, and tumorigenesis should also decrease. Now that's gonna let us eliminate answer choice C, right? Because answer choice C says that AKT activation should increase. And so now we're basically left with D, and if you just had to go by process of elimination, you could probably just go ahead and pick D here, but the reasoning for D makes sense because P1K3 alpha, right, promotes tumor growth. So if we decrease the activation of P1K3 alpha, then we would have a reduction in tumorigenesis. So D makes sense and is our best answer here. Alrighty, now we got our last question here for question five. So this one says, the reaction catalyzed by FASN produces which of the following fatty acids? And they've given us four different structures here. So we just need to identify which one of these fatty acids, fatty acid synthase catalyzes the production of. The easiest way to solve this is just by knowing the fact that there is only one fatty acid humans can synthesize de novo, and that's going to be palmitic acid. Palmitic acid is a 16-carbon saturated fatty acid. And that's exactly what answer choice A looks like here, right? There's 16 carbons and it's saturated. We could eliminate B because this one only has 14 carbons if we count them up. So B, let's go ahead and eliminate that. We can eliminate answer choice C because there's 18 carbons. And then it's also not fully saturated. And then for D, if we count the carbons, there are 16 carbons. However, it is also, like C, not fully saturated. So this isn't going to be palmitic acid either. So that just leaves us with A as our best answer. Alrighty, so that's going to wrap things up for us here today. If you found this video helpful, please give it a like. Subscribe to stay up to date with all of our content. And if you would like to check out the link in the description below, you'll be able to get a free MCAT question of the day sent to your email pretty much every morning. It's something I actually did even before I started here at Shemmassian. I found it really helpful, really got my brain going in the morning and get in the zone for, you know, a day of studying for the MCAT. So hope you guys found this helpful. We'll see you next time.